Well, good afternoon. My name is Wayne Pittard. I'm the director of the Spurlock Museum, and I'd like to welcome you here to the Spurlock. If you you won't have time after the lecture today to walk through the museum, but if you come back, you should take a look. We're a world cultures museum and have remarkable collections in several areas of the world on display. I'm also the chair of the George A. Miller Committee, and today's lecture is one of a series of major public events named in honor of Professor George Miller. Miller was a noted mathematician who taught at the University of Illinois in the first half of the 20th century. He was a quiet and unassuming man, devoted to the university, and at his death in 1951, he left his estate to the campus, quote, to be used for educational purposes other than current general operating expenses. The estate amounted to nearly $1 million, which in 1951 was a very considerable sum, still is not an inconsiderable sum today. The Miller Committee series began shortly after that as one of several ways to honor Professor Miller's wishes. Our lecture today is hosted by the Department of Mathematics. It is co-sponsored by a wide range of campus units that you can see listed on the flyer for this lecture. Gives you an indication of how many departments are interested in Dr. Turok's visit here. We thank all of them for their support. Today's lecture is the final MillerComm lecture for the spring semester. Fall semester schedule will appear shortly on the Center for Advanced Studies website, so I would encourage you to take a look there over the summer or at the beginning of next semester to get a sense of what's going to come up. A lot of interesting things coming up. We also encourage you to sign up for the center's mailing list at cas.illinois.edu. For faculty, information will also be available on the CAS site for applying for MillerComm lectureships for next spring semester. And I would encourage you to think about inviting a scholar and applying for MillerComm lecture status in the fall. So, now let us turn to today's guest, Neil Turok, who will be introduced this afternoon by Professor Stephen Bradlaugh of the Department of Mathematics.
So thanks on behalf of the math department and all the other sponsors of today's event. It's a great honor to introduce Professor Neil Turok. So it goes without saying that speakers in the MillerComm series have distinguished records of achievement in their fields, and certainly in this regard, Neil is no exception. But what is exceptional is that Neil's remarkable accomplishments are not confined to just one arena. You actually need look no further than his schedule for today to see what I mean. This morning he gave a seminar in physics entitled On Quantum Tunneling, and he's here now to talk about the amazing network of institutes for mathematical sciences that he brought into being across Africa. I think if there's one common thread running through Neil's astonishing CV, it's perhaps his insistence on thinking big. As a cosmologist, he's tackled arguably the ultimate question, namely the very origins of the universe, while his goal for the African Institutes is not merely to train African scientists, but to unleash the next Einstein. Neil began his career in physics with a PhD at Imperial College London, and after stints at the Institute for Theoretical Physics in Santa Barbara and at Fermilab, in 1994 he became professor of physics at Princeton, and in 97, he was appointed to the chair of mathematical physics in the Department of Applied Math and Theoretical Physics at Cambridge University. Since 2008, he's been the director of the Perimeter Institute for Theoretical Physics in Waterloo, Canada. He's published nearly 200 scientific papers, which, according to the Web of Science Citation Index, have been cited over 10,000 times. Born in South Africa, Neil left the country at a young age when his family was forced to flee as a result of his parents' involvement in anti-apartheid politics. But responding to an urgent need for scientific training, not just in the new South Africa, but across the whole continent, in 2003, Neil founded the African Institute for Mathematical Sciences, AIMS, a remarkable place about which I'm sure Neil will have much more to say in his talk. For his scientific work and his work on AIMS, he was awarded the 2008 TED Prize. So this annual $1 million prize is awarded to a leader with a fresh, bold vision for sparking global change, and was used by Neil to launch the Next Einstein Initiative. That's the subject of today's talk. Neil has received multiple honorary degrees, most recently from the Nelson Mandela Metropolitan University in Port Elizabeth, South Africa. And as if all this isn't enough, he's a master expositor of science. Last year, he received the Lane Anderson Award for Excellence in Canadian Science Writing for his book, The Universe Within, From Quantum to Chaos. So I first heard Neil give a talk 2 years ago at AIMS South Africa. I was lucky enough to be teaching a course there, and by coincidence, Neil was in town for an AIMS Council meeting. So taking advantage of his visit, AIMS had arranged for Neil to address the students, which Neil did, and I sat near the back of the room and watched as Neil spoke informally about his own story and how he came to start AIMS, about his vision for AIMS and African science, but mostly about his dreams for the students. And so you have to understand that all AIMS students naturally radiate a level of eager, good-natured engagement that is really one of the unique pleasures of teaching there. But even by AIMS standards, the rapt attention and excitement in the room was quite remarkable. And at the end of Neil's talk, the students really all had stars in their eyes and almost literally floated out the room on a cloud of inspiration. And so I have no doubt that by the end of today's talk, you'll know exactly what I mean. So without further ado, it's a great pleasure to introduce Neil.
So can everyone hear me all right? Good. Excellent. Well, thank you very much for the kind introductions. Great pleasure to be here. And I really want to congratulate the organizers on this great poster, which spells out what or depicts what we're trying to do with AIMS. So this talk is really, as you might have guessed, a sort of cosmologist's take on African development. And you know, I fell into the topic of African development partly by my personal background. My parents were political activists, and my father has, in fact, just stepped down from parliament as one of the oldest serving MPs in South Africa and the chair of the Ethics Committee in parliament. He's responsible for investigating MPs or ministers who have strayed from the straight and narrow. So I was sort of brought in to existence in a family that was completely committed to pursuing change in Africa, and spent 4 years in East Africa as a child. Those were the best years of my life in many ways. And I brought all that with me to England and to my professional career. And so when I finally got a chance to do something in 2001, when I went back to visit my parents, this is what sprang to my mind. So I want to begin by giving you my perspective on where we are right now, where humanity is right now. And it's a perspective of a physicist and a cosmologist, but also, I hope, a human being. We live at a very special moment in human history where we've begun to see large portions of the universe which were previously inaccessible. We've just seen results from the most powerful microscope ever built, the Large Hadron Collider, which can probe nature on a scale of a billionth the size of an atom. and also results from the Planck satellite, which can probe the universe on a scale 10 trillion times bigger than the solar system. And the fact that in both cases, theorists using well-known and well-founded formulae predicted more or less exactly what was seen, I think is really amazing. It tells us something about who we are as human beings, that we are able, for some reason we do not understand, to comprehend nature on scales absolutely remote from our everyday lives, absolutely remote from our origins, in evolutionary terms. Quite what this means, I don't know, but I think it's very important. And so the first part of my talk is going to be about this. Here's the Higgs discovery at the Large Hadron Collider in the highest energy particle collisions ever created. But this is the paper which predicted the Higgs boson. And by the way, the Higgs boson is just is not really just a particle. It's telling us about the vacuum. It's telling about what fills space, telling us about what breaks symmetry in the universe, incredibly fundamental discovery. And here is the paper which announced the prediction of the Higgs boson by Peter Higgs, and it's 1.5 pages. Okay. And this earned him the Nobel Prize. So in a sense, you might say theorists have it easy. Okay, but there's another way of looking at it, that the type of insight which this represents is really quite unique. And it epitomizes this capacity we have at various moments. Certain people are lucky to be the ones to actually make the discovery, to see into the heart of nature very, very deeply, using a combination of mathematical arguments and theoretical principles, physical principles, and that's what happened with the Higgs boson. And here is Peter Higgs, who's a charming old gentleman, and he's standing in the greatest, in the tunnel at the greatest experiment ever built, pretending that he knows what's happening. And I can assure you he has no idea how this machine works. Okay. But what he does understand is the principles which gave rise to the prediction of the Higgs boson. It's just a, you know, I view this as a perfect example of how we know we are able to do much more than we know and appreciate. And this Higgs discovery is a perfect example of that. On the opposite scale, here's a map of the entire visible universe due to made by the Planck satellite. And it doesn't look like much. It looks like a blotchy picture. But if you analyze this carefully, you discover ripples of sound which were formed in the process of the Big Bang. And these ripples take a very precise form, precisely in agreement with theoretical expectations based on rather simple arguments. And so we've seen the whole universe for the first time, and amazingly enough, it fits into a simple mathematical picture developed by physicists. Now, many of you will have heard about this latest result from the BICEP team operating at the South Pole. And so they've been using a telescope for the last 5 or so years, staring at what they hope is the quietest place in the sky, trying to look at very, very tiny signals, a hundred millionth of a degree signals in the pattern of radiation coming from the Big Bang. And what they've claimed is that they can see evidence here of a sort of swirly pattern representing gravitational waves created during the earliest moments of the Big Bang. If true, this is absolutely mind-boggling in its implication. It means we can literally see the Big Bang using gravitational waves. They are somewhat like X-rays that allow us to look right through the hot plasma of the early universe and see its beginning. So this is incredibly exciting, but I think, in my opinion, people have somewhat run away with their enthusiasm. And there, when you look carefully at this, there are a number of concerns and worries, and this certainly needs verification. I have to admit, I have a vested interest in this question, because Stephen Hawking bet me 12 years ago that these waves would be seen. Because according to his favorite theory of the Big Bang, they are a natural consequence. And I bet him they would not be seen, because in my favorite theory, these were not expected. So Stephen is very forthright in his bets, and he went on the BBC radio and he said, "I've won my bet with Neil." And I said, "Hang on a second, in science we need confirmation of an experimental claim." And then Stephen wrote me an email, this was a little over a week ago, saying, "Don't be a bad loser." Okay, I paid $100 for the Higgs boson, and this is because he bet against it. And he said, "This is much more important, so I think you should pay me $200. Because we'd never agreed an amount before. Now, the wonderful thing is that Stephen has actually never won a bet. Okay. And so my belief is that merely Stephen's backing this result is an almost certain guarantee that it's wrong. Okay. And we will learn soon. I mean, I wish it were right. I wish it were true. But there are bothersome things like foregrounds. I mean, cosmology is not particle physics. Particle physics is the most precise, controlled, careful laboratory situation. In cosmology, you're looking out through a galaxy which is full of dust and magnetic fields and all kinds of complications, and this could well be what they've seen. But we will see. It's tremendously exciting. The conclusion I draw from these discoveries, both the Higgs boson and the Planck satellite, is that the universe has turned out to be astonishingly simple, simpler than theorists expected. If you went to CERN just after the Higgs was discovered and wandered around CERN, as I did, you would see lots of theorists with long faces, okay, because all their models were disproved. The model which survived was the 50-year-old model, the very first model invented by Peter Higgs, the simplest possible picture consistent with other physics. And the Planck satellite, similarly, this map of the sky I showed you, is almost perfectly scale invariant, which means it's the deviations in uniformity, the density variations in the universe, are almost the same on every scale, as far as we can see, as they came out of the Big Bang. It's the simplest thing you could imagine. And secondly, they take the form of Gaussian random noise, which is also known as the normal distribution in statistics. It's again the simplest distribution you might expect. So the universe turned out to be incredibly, utterly simple. It's very simple on tiny scales, the Higgs boson scale, very simple on large scales. It's really complicated in the middle, okay, which is where we live. And that seems to be the way the universe works. It's extremely encouraging for both for attempts to understand the principles governing the universe, because that's what people like me do. We're trying to discover why the universe is so simple. What explains the pattern of particles and forces that we see. And this, the fact it is so simple is extremely encouraging. It's very challenging, too. It tells us that the most popular ideas are probably wrong. Ideas of supersymmetry and grand unification and string theory and extra dimensions and all of the pursuits. I'm being censored now. I'm being censored by my colleagues. all of these very popular ideas may well be wrong, and what we need are simpler, more profound principles which may be able to explain why the universe is so incredibly, utterly simple on very large and very small scales. But it's not only encouraging for our attempts to understand the universe, it has a much bigger meaning, because it's encouraging for our ability to open doors to our future. Okay, what do I mean by that? What I mean is that in the big picture of human history, understanding the universe and the way it works has been the key to progress. And it's amazing how little this is actually discussed or talked about, but it is absolutely central to the whole of human history. And by the way, like all good things come from Africa, and mathematics is one of those good things. And people don't often discuss that mathematics too came from Africa. This is the Ishango bone, which has notches marked on it, which include all the prime numbers less than 20, and it is 20,000 years old, and it's being kept in a colonial museum in Belgium, King Leopold's Museum, but it's a remarkable artifact, and in fact they're currently planning a movie on this bone, remarkable bone, which somehow represents the origin of mathematics, and there's a little YouTube movie you'll find about it if you search. Of course, the pyramids, the world's oldest astronomical observatory in southern Egypt, near to the Sudan, Nabta Playa, and this is about 3000 BC. And then, of course, we go into ancient Greece, and here's the physicist, and here's the mathematician. And you see what physicists do. Okay, we cheat. We cheat by looking at what the mathematicians have worked out, and then we also cheat by looking at the answer, which is the universe, and we try to reconcile these two things. And if we're really good at cheating, then we figure out how things actually work. This was Anaximander, who's probably the world's first physicist, and of course Pythagoras. And then if we go through the history of physics, and I won't go through all of it, but you all know that Galileo and Newton discovered the laws of mechanics, without which none of modern engineering would work. And then, of course, we have Maxwell and Faraday, who discovered electricity and magnetism and how they work. And then we have Thomson, who discovered the electron, Madame Curie, discovered radioactivity, and in many ways the beginnings of quantum mechanics, because there were random particles were emerging at random out of this radioactive material, and so on through the 20th century. I include somebody which you should all know very well here, the only person to win two Nobel Prizes in physics, John Bardeen. And I'll say a little bit more about him in a moment. But in this sort of grand sweep of human history, the discoveries these people made were really the root of every single technology we have today, from smartphones to NMR to airplanes to you name it. Every single thing on which our lives depend was discovered by human beings thinking about the universe and making sense of it. I'm going to particularly talk about the root of quantum theory, Einstein and Max Planck, and also Thomson, because he discovered the electron, and the effect of this on society. Now, it took some time. Their discoveries were made at the turn of the century, the 1900s, but in 1947, here is John Bardeen inventing, with Brattain and Shockley, the first transistor. And boy, it's an ugly thing. Okay. But that is the very first transistor, which they invented at Bell Labs. And basically, it's just a tap, which you can use to control the flow of electricity, like a tap used to control flow of water. And once you can control the flow of electricity very delicately, very carefully, then all kinds of things become possible. And so following their discovery and subsequent developments, the miniaturization of transistors into microprocessors, and the very first microprocessor in 1965 had four transistors on it, and ever since then, the number of transistors has roughly doubled every 2 years. The number of transistors you can fit onto inside a microprocessor has has doubled every 2 years. And doubling and doubling and doubling again is a very effective way to grow. And so we get to the 2000s, and we now have 10 billion or so transistors inside a typical device. I think we're all aware this has totally changed human society, and nowhere more so than in Africa. In Africa, Africa really is in many ways on the leading edge of the information revolution. Cell phones spread wildly across Africa and are used for everything, and in fact Africa is now called the Silicon Valley of banking, because mobile banking in Africa is huge, and people are using cell phones to pay their employees. It's much safer than people carrying around banknotes and getting robbed and so on. And so Africa really has benefited enormously from this digital revolution. But in the big picture of human history, I want to look to the future and to see what's coming next. And we know from the laws of physics that this digital revolution is going to come to an end, just because the size of transistors are now shrinking towards the size of the atom. And when they reach the size of the atom, you cannot deal with nature in the way that electrical engineers do, because nature is not classical. It's not like water flowing in a pipe. Electricity is no longer like water flowing in a pipe. Instead, nature on these tiny scales is completely quantum. And so you have to deal with nature on quantum terms, and that's why the Institute, which I'm director of, and our partner institutes are very involved in trying to understand what might replace modern electronics. The quantum electronic devices, quantum computers, quantum sensors, quantum communicators, and we believe very strongly that this is what's coming. So that's the background to this picture. This talk is all about Africa, and the challenge is to get Africa into the future. We have to think about where the world is going and to prepare Africa to participate and to be involved. Now, these children are from the Central African Republic, which you might have read about is undergoing a terrible civil war and catastrophic violence and disruption of society and so on. And here they are. The one thing Africa has, as compared to other continents, is a very young population and a very rapidly growing population. African families typically have 5 children. The average is 5 children, whereas on other continents it may be 1 or 2. And this very young population is both, and by the way, the resulting growth in population is much faster than any other continent. So that by the year 2050, according to current projections, 1 in 3 young people on the planet, that is people under 21, will be African. And so there are a lot more young Africans coming. And the world has a choice. Either we provide educational opportunities to advance themselves and lead productive lives, or we don't, and it will be a catastrophe. So obviously, I choose the former. And therefore, it is absolutely essential that the world engages with Africa and provides young African kids like this opportunities. In fact, in my view, Africa represents the world's greatest untapped pool of scientific talent. Almost every other continent has participated in leading-edge science already. In major ways, but Africa has yet to enter in a big way, and I personally believe that when Africa does enter, it will change everything. Because when you think of what Africa has done for music or art, Africa has done so much in terms of creativity and originality, and that's what we need in science to make big discoveries. So I view Africa as a huge resource for the planet, and the challenge is to use that resource wisely. Africa also gave the world a person who, in my opinion, was the greatest leader of the 20th century, Nelson Mandela. And I'm not doing this to idolize one, I'm not saying this to idolize one individual. It's who he represents. And this is what I learned as a child in Africa, is that there was a human spirit of tolerance, respect, commonality, community in Africa, which is unequaled in my experience anywhere else. And Mandela was definitely a product of his people, but he was at the same time, I think, unquestionably the greatest leader that we've seen in the example he set. And the question is Africa going to produce more Mandelas? Is it going to produce an Einstein? When will we see a young African make the kind of breakthrough discoveries that Einstein did and completely transform stereotypes, racial stereotypes and bigotry by doing so in the same way that Einstein did? Sometimes people don't remember at the end of the 19th century, Jews were very much discriminated against. In fact, in the middle of the 19th century, Jews were not allowed to go to university and study engineering or maths or physics because these technical subjects were thought to be inappropriate for Jews who were just money lenders and traders. But when Jews started to get into university in Europe, they had a point to prove. They wanted to show the world they could do it. And because of that frame of mind, when they got into physics and mathematics and other fields, they became revolutionaries, as Einstein was, and they changed everything. And that's what I believe Africa is also capable of. So, my clicker isn't working. Maybe the batteries run out. You've skipped one. So, with this in mind, that Africa, this huge pool of young Africans needs to, we need to create the conditions in which from this huge pool, people like Mandela and people like Einstein and people who actually combine both those qualities should emerge. That should be our goal. With this in mind, we set up the African Institute for Mathematical Sciences. And as you can see, the logo shows Africa as a shining continent radiating a positive image, and it stands for AIMS, which is also a very positive word. And here it is. Well, when we started in 2003, we had no money, and we had no supporters, and we had a lot of skeptics, okay? And so we bought a derelict hotel in a suburb of Cape Town for $100,000. It was an 80-room hotel and falling apart, and invited students from all over Africa, just sent out posters all over Africa and invited students to come and study and invited the best lecturers we could find from all over the world to come and teach them. And basically, it's just a hotel where it's an extremely simple concept. You provide food, it's secure, there's a library, there's a computer lab, and everyone lives together. And within that environment, you try to create a spirit in which there is a constant sharing of knowledge. You try to get rid of the bureaucratic elements of universities, the sort of factory-style courses, which are typical of universities, and you try to replace it with something much more positive, and all, of course, driven by this gigantic aspiration that Africa needs to enter the world of science and to show what it can do. So we started in 2003. It was really an experiment. We raised funding from 10 or 15 different private foundations, small amounts of funding. Every student gets a full scholarship, and literally we just invited them to come and played it by ear to see what they would need, how we would design a curriculum. We allowed the students to inform the operations of the institute. It's very much an African institute. The whole atmosphere is African. It's a pan-African student body taken from the whole continent. The colonial rulers did their best to divide Africa. It's the most divided continent on the planet, with 54 countries, I think. And we view maths and science as unifiers. They're beyond any language. They're common to everyone. And they are the greatest treasures that humankind possesses. And so we need to share them. And that sharing is something which brings people from every culture together. We also try to recruit the very best lecturers in the world. If you want to leapfrog Africa to the future, to the quantum age, you can't afford second-rate lecturers. You need the best ones. And you know, if the West was serious about developing Africa, the first thing it would do is send all its best lecturers to Africa. Okay? People don't usually talk about that, but that's exactly what we tried to do. And we created a 24/7 learning environment. And literally, the students will be up in the computer lab till 3, 4 a.m., and then a few hours of sleep, up for breakfast, back in lectures in the morning, problem-solving classes, tutorials. The students call Ames the house of no sleep. Okay. And in fact, it's very hard to get them out of the building. When I'm there, I'm trying to get them to go outside sometimes. But they are so thrilled to be in an environment where they have every opportunity to study and learn that they do so very intensively. We have a slogan, which is we want Africa to be rich. That's an easy thing to remember, but rich for us means relevant, innovative, cost-effective, and high quality. And those are our basic principles. And on each one of these, Ames has tried to be very different to a conventional university and much more cost-effective. Cost-effectiveness, I can tell you the cost per student at Ames is about $10,000 per year. And when you compare that to a graduate student at the University of Illinois, it's about one-tenth. It simply makes no cost sense to bring African students for postgraduate work to the US rather than bring one lecturer to teach 50 students rather than 50 students to the US. Now, of course, we're not against people coming to do PhDs here. And I see quite a few Africans here. I hope some of you are doing PhDs. Not against that at all. What we want is to create strong institutions, training centers in Africa. And that's what Ames is all about. So here's an idea of what we do. The Ames curriculum, this is our standard master's program. You spend 3 months on skills courses, which are mostly mathematical and physical modeling, computation, data analysis, some communication. Every student gives talks from the moment they arrive. Then we do review courses, which are sort of brief exposures, three-week exposures, to exciting fields in science that the students might want to do after Ames. It's really just tasters. Financial maths, computer science, epidemiology, some entrepreneurship training. And the goal here is really to expose students to things they haven't seen before, which might be areas for them to pursue a fruitful career. And then finally, there's a research phase in which they are supervised and they do a project and an essay and eventually give a presentation supervised by senior academics at local partner institutions, as well as international scientists. And exams, this is very important. There are no written exams at Ames. If you saw the students' reaction to traditional exams, you would know why we don't do it. Exams are literally used to brutalize students in African universities. The way in which they're held is often extremely unreasonable, and rote learning at best, and at worst just simply bias, propagation of bias on the part of the lecturers. And so we got away from that, and so the exams are all oral plus continuous assessment. There are typically 8 live-in tutors who are with the students, about 60 students, about 8 tutors with them throughout the year, and the tutors are watching the students all the time, interacting with them, evaluating them every week, and giving them extra support where they need it. This is a sort of typical Ames graduation. The one tradition we've not been able to get rid of is gowns. Okay, people love gowns, and they desperately want to graduate in their gowns. And it's my life's mission to persuade people that we've got to do something a bit more modern than a gown, but I have not succeeded. They love gowns, and I want you to notice that a good fraction of the students here are women. Ames insists on having a minimum of 30% women in every class, and we've succeeded very well in doing so. And the women, in fact, are a special success story. Women find in this sort of safe, supportive environment, away from their family problems, where they can really focus on their studies, they do exceptionally well. And the speeches given by women at graduation are always the best ones. So this is Africa, and we started Ames in 2003. It surprised everyone at how quickly it got going, how cheap it was, how effective it was, how prominent it became so quickly. And in 2008, when I was awarded this TED Prize, they asked me to make a wish to change the world. Okay, so very naively, I said, okay, well, I wish there were 15 Ames centers. And I thought with Bill Gates and Larry Page in the audience, it would just be funded like that, because it really is very cheap. They could do it in an instant. But what I didn't realize is that by publicly committing myself to this, I now had to do it. Okay, and there was a little bit of support from the audience, but really very, very small. And so this public declaration, which I made on behalf of the whole organization, such as it was, it's a small organization, committed us to creating these 15 centers across Africa. So it was quite a burden to carry, okay? But this was our concept, that we would create a Pan-African institute of very high quality, postgraduate education, opening doors to careers in any technical field for Africa's brightest graduates. So 2008 was the TED Prize, and 2011 we actually opened the first new center in Senegal. And I want to show you that picture because I like it. There you see us dancing. There's lots of dancing at Ames centers. You go to Africa, partying is the order of the day. This is Klaus von Klitzing, who's the Nobel Prize winner, quantum Hall effect, dancing with the Ames students. Ames Senegal is a spectacular place in a nature reserve just south of Dakar, and it's now into its fourth year. Ames Ghana opened in 2012. Here's another graduation, again in a beautiful seaside location, overlooking a beach. And then last year, Ames Cameroon opened, and just a month ago, we had the formal opening. The Prime Minister and 7 ministers attended. There were 1,000 people in the biggest hall in Yaoundé, the capital. And just to give you an impression of the atmosphere, which was quite incredible, the Prime Minister had heard that Ames wants Africa to get into the quantum age, okay? And Ames wants Africa to make the next Einstein. And so the Prime Minister, in his public speech in front of everyone, he said, I want this center, it's a tiny center, it's got 34 students in a converted hotel. Okay, I want this center to be the sub-regional hub for science, technology, and innovation. Okay, and I'm telling you now that any proposal you present to me with the word quantum in the title will be funded. Okay, Now, he's actually a brilliant man, and we met him privately, and he said, you know, it may have sounded like a joke, but I'm dead serious. I want to be at the leading edge. I'm fed up with Africa being second rate. We have resources, and the Cameroon government has committed $5 million to the center. It's a very serious commitment. And we want to catch up, and quickly. Tanzania will open this year in Dar es Salaam. Here's the president of Tanzania, again made a very strong commitment. And I have to mention one person who has been absolutely key to this whole plan. This is Thierry Zomerhoun. He is the executive director in Africa. He was a street kid. He was born in Benin, was a street kid for 5 years, from the age of 6 to 11, was abandoned by his family, and rescued by his grandmother off the streets. Now he has 3 master's degrees in theology, journalism, and Canada's top MBA at McGill University. And basically this, he's an incredible person who's an expert in management and management systems, and he has pulled this whole network together. These are the countries which have supported AIMS financially, and I want you all to feel very embarrassed. Okay, because South Africa, this is Senegal, Ghana, Cameroon, Tanzania, Canada in 2010 gave $20 million to support the growth of AIMS. The UK in 2011 committed $28 million as a matching fund. So whatever African governments or companies give operating in Africa, the UK government will match up to a total of 28, so it's actually $56 million. And Germany is committed and is supporting chairs now at AIMS centers, several chairs, and they will support a big event we hope to hold next year called the Next Einstein Forum, which will be in Senegal next year. And France has contributed land to AIMS Senegal. But I don't see the United States. And that's got to change. It's absolutely ridiculous. So every one of you in this audience should feel some responsibility for contributing towards this. I met with the chancellor of the university today and explained to her about AIMS. I want the University of Illinois to lead the involvement of US universities in this project. And she sounded amenable, but she needs some pressure. The cost is really minimal, but it requires real engagement and real commitment. For comparison, 6 Canadian universities have joined, and they each contribute $50,000 per year to this project. You see, we have a program called One for Many. You pay the cost of one student on your campus, which in Canada is about 50,000, in the US about 100,000, and that money goes to AIMS, where it supports either 5 or 10 students. And that's just a sensible investment, because you're investing in high-level training for African students who you can then recruit to your programs at your university and then legitimately claim to be an international university. If you're not doing this, I think you cannot legitimately claim. If you're not actually investing in the growth of institutions in Africa, then I think you're simply parasitically living off Africa's riches, and maybe that's strong, but that's how I feel. Okay, AIMS governance. How do we operate this network? We were reviewed by the Canadian government, the UK government, and they concluded that every aspect of AIMS was different. Every aspect was innovative. And I have to say that as a cosmologist, I mean, I am the most impractical non-management-oriented person that I know. But when you create an institution from scratch, you get a chance to redesign everything. It's really wonderful. And most people who work in universities never get that chance. And they just assume things have to go this way because they've always gone this way. So it was really an amazing opportunity to start this little institute on its own where we could do everything the way, from first principles. And the governance is a key thing. And you'll notice in this diagram that the governing board is at the bottom, okay, of the diagram, because our job is to support, right, not to direct, not to control. And this is just one example of how we operate in a very unusual fashion. In fact, essentially, the Next Einstein Initiative Foundation is a funding agency. The funding agency raises funds from governments, from private foundations, and then manages those funds and distributes it to the centers, so the centers are completely accountable for everything they spend, but the secretariat of the organization is there to support them. And here's the summary of what we've achieved in one decade. Four centers of excellence so far, with a fifth soon to come. 560 alumni, 180 students are now at Ames. The total number of student applications per year is about 1,500. So we're selecting a little, maybe one in nine, something like that. 31% women, 38 nationalities, they come from everywhere in Africa. 65% of our alumni are currently in Africa, and of the remainder, most are doing PhDs overseas with a stated intention of at least coming back to Africa at some point and at least contributing in some way. And then post-Ames degree, there are 250 PhDs either completed or in progress, 372 masters, and there are four research chairs currently, with many more to come. Here's one of our biggest outputs, which is just alumni who are now working, teaching in African universities. And so here they all are, and essentially what Ames is doing is renewing the math and physics and computer science faculty across Africa, many of whom are rather old. I'll give you some examples. Here's Angelina. She comes from northwest Tanzania, Dodoma. It's an area ridden with HIV, decimated by HIV/AIDS. And she did a double math physics degree in Tanzania, then came to Ames, and now she's a senior researcher at the Ifakara Health Institute in Dar es Salaam, using mathematical models to study malaria and better ways of treating malaria. I love this photo. This is a photo of Martial. Here he is, born to a very poor family in Cameroon, one of six children. His mother was a market trader. She sold a certain kind of leaf, which is a vegetable in Cameroon. And her husband left her, and she single-handedly built their own home out of bricks, which she made herself, concrete building bricks she made herself, and built her house on a disused piece of land. Amazing woman who managed to support all six of her kids all the way through university. And Martial is one of them. And when he went through university, he came top in Cameroon in mathematics. But had no opportunity, had no PhD opportunity until he came to Ames. And by the way, when I met, I went to his mother's house, and she cooked me a meal. And when we'd finished, I said to her, "I don't understand how you've managed to do all this. Where did you get the strength from to overcome everything you've overcome?" And she turned to me and she said, "There's only one answer, and the Lord gave me strength." And I found that very, very moving. I mean, I think it's maybe fashionable for academics to dismiss religion and religious beliefs, but I'm not one of those. And I think what I interpret the words to mean is she found an inner strength within her, and we don't really understand where this inner strength comes from. But it's there in abundance, in Ames, in the Ames students, in their families, in their origins, and it gives these students incredible power. incredible motivation, incredible commitment to do the right thing. And so here's Martial as a kid, and here he is today. He's a staff scientist at Yale. He's a senior researcher in mathematical epidemiology, and he's publishing papers in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences. He's a very strong mathematician and absolutely committed to using his science for good purposes, and an amazing individual. Here's another student's background, Ethiopia, the rural areas in Ethiopia. At the time this student was born, the infant mortality rate was 20% in this region. This is her village. And it's an area which is subject to drought and famine and so on. So she was given up by her family and taken by an aunt to the city in the hope of finding a better life. And here she is today. This is Kidist, and she's with Stephen Hawking. This was at the launch of the Next Einstein Initiative. Here she is again. And Kidist is now a computational numerical analyst, let's say, and she's using numerical methods to study particularly biological problems involving biology and fluids. And she's at the University of North Carolina, Computational Mathematics Center. She's a postdoc, and here she is meeting with one of AIM's newest supporters, who you might recognize, and convincing him that AIMS is good. And he was very convinced. So Kidist is again one of our stars. These are the partners in AIMS, the governments, African governments, some international governments, not the US. We have the African Union has strongly supported AIMS and various companies. This is really just the beginning. In Africa, we work cooperatively with the universities, the three universities in Cape Town, the Center for Epidemiology, the Astronomical Observatory, and so on. So we work very much in tandem with the universities, but we claim we can offer them a new dose of energy, because we will bring fantastic international lecturers, we'll bring these fantastic students from all over Africa. The universities actually accredit the degrees. We're not interested in accrediting degrees. And so the three university partners just take a third of the students at random, and they give them master's degrees. And in this way, it's really a partnership of mutual benefit. Same thing in Ghana and in Senegal and in Cameroon. Internationally, I'm very pleased that Illinois does now appear here. The departments of math, physics, and the graduate school have joined as partners to AIM South Africa. I'm trying to persuade the University of Illinois to join as a full partner to the network, and we'll see if that happens. But we're growing this list of partners who participate in various ways. As I mentioned, next year we're planning an event. This is supposed to be the Davos of science. I think everyone's bored with Davos right now. The most exciting news from Davos this past year was that, you know, somebody's projections for interest rates, they'd be 1.25% rather than 1.5 or something like that. So we think there's a case that there should be a global science forum called the Next Einstein Forum. It should be in Africa, because that's really the venue, that's the next venue where something great is going to happen in terms of growing science. And the focus should be on these pools of talent which need developing, especially in Africa, but also elsewhere in the developing world. And so we're hoping this will be a very high-profile international event, held probably in October next year, and probably in Senegal. So just to end, As I mentioned, from my perspective, Africa has successfully leapfrogged into the use of mobile technology, particularly internet, digital technology. But what is needed now is that we prepare Africa for coming scientific revolutions, like the quantum revolution. And what that means is giving people broad problem-solving skills, access to global, to top international scientists, connections around the world, and above all, it means believing in them, believing that they can do it. And I, from all of my experience in Ames, when you believe in students and you believe they can do it, they will exceed your wildest hopes. Thank you very much.
Professor Turok has offered to answer questions for a little while, so we have a microphone that we would like you to use when you ask a question. So raise your hand and Professor Turok will call on you, but wait for the microphone to get down.
Okay.
Thank you, that was amazing. I wonder if there are similar initiatives to try and start energy in biological sciences and medical sciences. It seems like that would be another obvious area for expansion for Africa.
Absolutely. I mean, I think there's certain features of the Ames model that are unique and have proven themselves to work. Number one, try to take students from the whole continent. Have a mixed student body of all cultures, Muslim, Christian, Francophone, Anglophone. Be culture blind, okay? And use the science to bring everyone together. And that's worked incredibly well. The level of trust and confidence the students develop is totally unique and very inspiring to anybody who lectures there. The other fields, of course, maths is the easiest. You don't really need any equipment at all. I mean, okay, some laptops and a few books. But maths is just the easiest, the cheapest, and it's, of course, foundational. So, you know, when I ask experimentalists, what qualities would you most value in your graduate student? And it's very clear, they say they need to know how to use a computer, analyze data, and, make sense of experimental data. They can learn the other stuff, okay, but those skills are very valuable. Mathematical skills are very valuable right across the sciences. So in a way, mathematics was the no-brainer to start with that. Mathematical science, I mean, it's not pure mathematics. Some of them will do it, but most of them are doing applied mathematical thinking, let's call it that. Biology is much harder because you need labs. And quite frankly, there's an alternative model which operates in Africa, which is things like the World Health Organization, other organizations have set up biological labs in Africa. And those are the absolute opposite of Ames. What they are ivory tower labs where Western researchers come and earn tax-free salaries and study materials from the African environment and publish lots of papers, and there is zero spin-off in terms of scientific and technical training in Africa. So that's a sort of alternative model which is a danger. If you have a very fancy biological lab, that's what it can become. And quite, Africa has just won the greatest telescope of the next decades, the Square Kilometer Array. So the biggest telescope in the world will be in Africa, based in South Africa, but spread across the continent. And this quite frankly, is another danger, that the Square Kilometer Array is just used by Western astronomers to fly in, take the data, fly out again, and we don't see the spin-off. So I think we have to be very active in ensuring there's a flow of young African astrophysicists and astronomers who can utilize this telescope and make discoveries. So that's a long answer to a simple question. I mean, I would say our job is to do this. Other people can learn from us. We're very happy to share our experience. I've talked to lots of people, they all say, oh, you should do this in biology, and you should do this in chemistry, and you should do this. Well, you know, thanks. Why don't you do some? There's room for everybody. Yeah.
I've done a little bit of work in developing countries, and I found a real block for people being successful are negotiation skills, how to write a resume, how to publish in peer-reviewed journals, how to stay away from what I've learned they call predator journals. And so I was wondering, you mentioned communication and learning to write, and I'm sure that's a part of it, but
yes.
Do you, these issues, and you've shown some successes,
yes.
But do you have a curriculum that includes that? Because
yes.
These people are really out in the cold otherwise.
Yes, I mean, you can understand why. I mean, a lot of people like to hold summer schools in Africa. Okay, so a bunch of Western lecturers flies out to Africa, spends 3 weeks, has a great time, and maybe co-opts one or two African co-authors of a few papers, and that's about it. It's just not serious. Okay, so there are very, very few people who are trying to do something serious. If you do something serious, you need to sustain it over a period of time. It needs, I would say, needs to at least be a 10-month program. You need to actively support the students after that program. So for example, Ames raises money for half scholarships. So we use these half scholarships after Ames to leverage PhD scholarships from the universities. And as a result of this, the Ames graduates are very successful. They're very good at getting into PhD programs and publishing and so on. I mean, these tricks and skills of learning how to be a successful scientist are just learned, you know, over coffee. I mean, that's the best way to learn. You bring a bunch of great lecturers, you bring tutors, you know, so some of these 8 tutors in each center, some of them will be international, and they share their experience and their ideas with the students. And it happens naturally, but it's got to be sustained, it's got to be serious, and it's got to be, you know, you really have to believe they will do it. But yeah, our experience is that there is no problem, but I honestly think many other organizations are doing it in a highly ineffective way. You have a question.
Thank you very much. My name is Vukoni, and I'm originally from Uganda. As a result of civil war in my own country, I ended up being exposed to the educational system, not only of Uganda, but Democratic Republic of Congo and Sudan, the part which is now the Republic of South Sudan. Mm. And from that experience, I can attest to something you mentioned about the high level of really, you know, discouragement in terms of exposure to science and students getting interested in science subjects.
Yes.
And to me, it seems one of the issues that I didn't hear you mention, is the disconnect between the language of science and the language that most Africans speak. Mm. And there's an abrupt switch from maybe being taught in the mother tongue, or even not at all, and being just immersed in this esoteric language. And I can tell you that destroys a whole lot of interest. So if we want the next Einstein to come from Africa,
yeah.
We need to pay attention to the level of disconnect.
Yeah.
And science ends up being seen as this alien
right.
Collection of disciplines. Yet a lot of science actually takes place even in very traditional settings, in villages
yes.
and so forth.
Yes.
So if there is a reconnection
yes.
with that environment, I think this project is going to be scaled at a quantum level to all this language.
Thank you. The point you make a very important point, and it's something which motivates us very much, this idea of connecting science to humanity. So the sub-theme of the theme of the Next Einstein Forum is actually connecting science to humanity. Now that for us, for me, means everything. That if I look at Africa today, at primary school, secondary school, university level, the way in which science and maths is taught has many, many problems, which, as you say, mean the students feel it is simply there as a subject to torture them, to force them to pass exams. It's not a miracle of nature. It's not a thing of wonder, you know, that we can understand nature and use this understanding to improve our conditions. This is not what's taught. Maths is presented as this means of torture. And at most, you may get a job as an accountant, okay? Counting money. I mean, that's the utility of maths. If you ask in Africa, what's maths for? It's for counting money. this aspect of reconnecting to nature. So I say this problem of the disconnect is extremely deep. And it goes back to the Middle Ages in Europe, where scientists became disconnected from humanists, let's say, from artists, from literary, literally in the Middle Ages in Cambridge in England, they separated the curriculum. Okay, so the scientists became a kind of elite, and then the other people specialized in law and history, and actually the other people went into government. Okay, so the scientists basically became technicians. And I think that's what happened in Western culture. Scientists became technicians. All they want is the next grant. Okay, they want to be supported to do their science, and they generally don't think much about the implications. Okay. On the contrary, the other people who are actually making decisions in government, in many countries, especially in the UK, which I'm most familiar with, they're all people from arts backgrounds, okay, who don't really know anything about science. And so there was this horrible disconnect, and I think the science suffers as a result, and society suffers even more. So honestly, my hope and wish is that in Africa, we can do it again. Because Africa is new to science, this time, let's try to do it right. So this time, science is seen as a wonderful, magical thing from which the whole of society will benefit. And so that's how we have to present the emergence of science in Africa. And I think because it's fresh, because it's new, because there's so much enthusiasm, we have a chance to do it right. But this is an absolutely fundamental point which I think the whole world has, in my opinion, has got it wrong. That science is, is the realm of geeks, and it shouldn't be. Science is the greatest miracle we know, and everyone should revel in science. But for that, science has to change. So that people really see this is the route to development. This is how human society progresses, is through discovery and then using those discoveries to improve our condition. Now, you mentioned a particular point about languages. And again, you know, this is Africa has like more than 300 languages. So in a typical AIMS class, there may be 50 languages represented. But the one thing is in common is that there's the power of mathematical thinking to make sense of the world, make sense of nature, and underlie science. That's a very powerful unifying concept. So I think the level of students we have, postgraduates, these are the, if you like, the fish who struggled so far upstream. I mean, they fought every possible disadvantage. We have women from Darfur. In fact, the woman singing the song at the beginning, she's a genocide survivor from Rwanda. She lost 24 family members in the genocide. She's the sole survivor of her family. And she's a mathematician and physicist. She also writes songs. As you saw, she's a poet. She's written her life story. And she's now at the École Polytechnique in Lyon in France, one of the top graduate programs in maths and physics. And she, just through her life, represents this whole aspiration. So I think we're trying to reach something which is extremely powerful and extremely unifying. But it's beyond school curricula, it's beyond the colonial legacy. We have to find ways to circumvent all those divisions.
Hello, thank you for your presentation.
Thank you.
My name is Suzanne, also a native of Uganda. And as a student, and as a, I guess I would term myself a global citizen, I am very highly concerned about the perspective and the views of those who would try to come and want to establish different initiatives that are all well-meaning and good intentions, which I do see your project seemingly doing. But I'm also very concerned that there's, like Rukoni said, I'm very concerned about institutions that do not utilize the local resources. You've made a lot of general comments. In particular, you said that we get the best of international lecturers, professors. Mm. And I'm wondering and concerned why you have not looked into, or really, to be honest, the question I wanted to ask is, out of all the continents of Africa, you could not find one, two, three internationally great, as you talked about, lecturers or professors that would teach at these Ames Institutes.
We do.
And
we
I didn't see that. Yeah. So I'm just kind of wondering, because a lot of what I would like to see happen is the local empowerment of the people.
Yeah.
Because as children, you see, when you see people in key positions, it brings, there's a level of empowerment that, to me, beyond mathematical and sciences can predict, that happens when a child sees someone that looks like them, and so on and so forth. So as an educational policy student here, I'm just kind of wondering what, how do you choose your professors or teachers? Where is the average teacher from? How do they relate to the students and so forth? Because again, my concern is, you made that statement about these great international lecturers and teachers.
Yes.
But I didn't see any mention of using the local universities and naming them and drawing from their expertise and knowledge and so forth, because I do believe science does exist in Africa, and it has not been a lot of the perspective of, like you again just mentioned, science is not new to Africa.
Mm-hmm.
It's not. Mm-hmm. And I think sometimes people get the perspective as if it's not going on, but it's there. It just needs to be exposed.
Yeah.
And so I just wanted to kind of hear from you about those, that particular level of selection process, and how you are using or not using, or why you're not choosing African universities, professors, and lecturers to be able to teach at Ames Institutes.
Okay, so probably because I didn't give enough detail, you would have noticed in the list of African universities, I did show a whole page of African universities. So I didn't give you enough detail, but let me just begin by saying your question raises an extremely important point, which is that most interventions from the outside in Africa have been failures, okay, for a variety of reasons. Personally, I feel I had a little bit of an advantage because I grew up in South Africa. My parents were in the struggle. It gave me a perspective of being absolutely committed to Africa rather than do good perspective from the outside. So we see this danger all the time, okay? Now, one of the beauties of the Ames model is that it's locally owned. Every center is locally owned by a trust, okay? So that's the legal entity that owns each center. The trust has trustees, which are very prominent people from the local community, universities, business, civil servants. These are the people who are the trustees, so it's absolutely locally owned. One of the clever things about the Ames model is that you bring in these excellent lecturers, okay, from outside. We have some African lecturers, but most of them are international lecturers. You bring them in, you only allow them to stay for 3 weeks, okay? So they're there to share what they know, and then off they go. They can't interfere too much, okay? That's a deliberate feature of the model. It's really dangerous to bring in international people and have them remain there in a position of authority, okay, because they're highly respected international, academics. So this is the one way it works, that you have, in the course of a year, about 30 lecturers come through. Of those, about 80% will be international, 20% African. And the ones who come through only stay for 3 weeks, okay? They can't do too much damage in 3 weeks. But they do try, okay? Because they all have very strong opinions, and they think this should happen, and that should happen, and the director's no good, and you should fire the tutors, and all that. Luckily, they leave after 3 weeks, okay? So this is one of the features of the model. It balances local ownership with international involvement. So you get the best out of the international involvement, but they don't control the institute. In fact, the whole method Ames operates is as a balance between all these different interests. The local universities form a council, and the council is the effective governing body of the center. Okay, so the universities are intimately involved, but in practice what it means is that the most enthusiastic advocates of the center from each university will join that council, and they will adopt its mission, as their own, the center's mission as their own. So it is a very delicate balance, but perhaps I didn't emphasize this strongly enough, but Ames is absolutely not an international aid project, okay? It's a project based in Africa, for Africa, run by Africans. Every Ames Center director is an African. And its whole mission is to make centers of excellence in Africa.
Thanks, I'll try and make it quick. Thank you very much for your presentation. I had a short question and then one big one. I just wasn't clear with the technicalities that students do a 9-month course and then they get a degree that sometimes is from UWC and sometimes it's from Stellenbosch and sometimes it's from UCT.
Yes.
And what is that degree called?
A master's.
That's a master's. And with that in hand, they then apply to do either a further master's or a PhD,
wherever
it is they want to go.
Exactly.
Okay, good. And then so that was a little question. Then the other one was just, the ultimate irony is all of the wonders of science are then embedded in the cruelty of coltan production for the cell phones in the Congo. And so
isn't there
also a role for a course on the history of science in your program?
There is. I mean, again, this touches on the point of how do we ensure that the Ames students grow up in the image not just of Einstein but of Mandela. How do they adopt that? I profoundly believe the best form of education is self-education. And so in a way what happens at Ames centers is you bring these very interesting students together And something automatically happens. They're all living together, right? And they're all sharing the same classes, and you're not torturing them with written exams, okay? You're providing support. And in this environment, they form reading groups, okay, and discussion groups. This is the best thing that can happen, okay? Because then they themselves are figuring out what they want to know. And then this, you know, if the students come to the director and say, we would love to have a lecture on X, you know, the center will help to arrange that. That's the best form. So we haven't specifically tried to design a curriculum in history or history of science or whatever. I suspect that would be quite difficult because it's, you know, it's much more subjective matter than math or computing, you know, or physics. And so one of the beauties of using math and physics and computer science to bring people together is it is relatively unsubjective. Okay, I mean 2 + 2 = 4 in any culture or language or tradition, and so having the core curriculum being those technical fields, but then trying to create an environment in which people pursue wider interests is really what we're about. I'll give you an example. I was teaching in Senegal in February, and a group of students on their own made a movie about Mandela, because when Mandela passed away, they felt they wanted to make a movie about Mandela. So to make that movie, they had to learn the history of the struggle in South Africa, and they put together lots of film clips, and it was actually a brilliant movie. And then they interviewed students and people in the town, the local town, on what they felt about Mandela. And it was great. So this kind, these students are likely to do this kind of thing, and in my view, this is the best way they can educate themselves.